Hello, everybody. I'm Dr. Steven Palter, the new media editor for Fertility and Sterility, and I'm coming to you today with a live interview for our November highlight focus article from the November issue of Fertility and Sterility. Today, we're with Dominique deZiegler from the University of Paris Descartes, and he's going to talk about his article on the value of growth hormone supplements in ART for poor ovarian response. We chose this article because the issue of growth hormone supplementation for IVF patients is hugely controversial. The data is unclear, and many practitioners are reluctant to use it or using it without a good understanding. So hopefully after our discussion, we'll have an understanding of the value of this as evidenced by the literature. Dominique, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Hi, Steven.
Hi, thank you for joining us. We're doing this in a new way this month. This is a live interview. I'm at the Global AAGL conference in Florida. Dominique is in Paris. We are recording using a cloud recording internet service, and we'll see how this works. Dominique, thank you so much. Please tell me the institution that you're at so I don't mispronounce it.
I'm Dominique deZiegler, and I'm working at Hôpital Cochin in Paris, which is one of the major gynecological hospitals in Paris.
Wonderful. So tell me, why did you choose to write this article about poor responders and growth hormone? Why was this important?
Steven, it is interesting. This is an article that is part of several in that month on poor responders, and the issue of growth hormone use in poor responders has been around for a long time. Actually, the first evidence of efficacy of growth hormone dates back from 20 years ago. And in spite of that, in spite of those evidence of efficacy, there is still not a consensus, and actually growth hormone is very rarely used for poor responders. So therefore, we thought that it was interesting to review the issue. It was also interesting because three meta-analyses had come out recently, and also because it was of interest for the readers of the journal to actually look at the issue also in relation with our new views about poor responders. The poor responders are actually made of several subgroups.
Right, so that was different in what you... That was very different in what you've done in your article. I mean, I'll tell the readers, there are three articles in the journal on poor responder together. One is the use of androgens, one is this one on growth hormone, and one is about the confusion we have simply on what is the definition of a poor responder. So if you could tell me how you chose to split up the analysis, are all poor responders the same or not?
In particular, the issue of growth hormone has been confused in part because growth hormone essentially does not increase the number of oocytes you get in the stimulation. In other words, the addition of growth hormone does not appear to increase the quantity of oocytes. And probably because of this, some have shied away from and have probably not realized that it may have an impact on the quality of oocytes. And this is why we thought that the reviewing of the data existing on growth hormone needed to be looked at under the two questions. Does it increase the number of oocytes, and does it increase the quality? And this is why we sought out the possible use of growth hormone according to those various circumstances.
The subgroups that you looked at were poor responders were split up in those that had age-related poor response, unexplained poor response, poor egg quality, and is that the differentiation between them?
Well, Steven, what has happened in the past, I would say 5 years, there's been evidence that link between the issue of quantity of oocytes and quality is not existing and is not inherent. Actually, the appearance of a link between a drop in quantity and a drop in quality that you see in aging women is the result of a confounding effect of age. The link does not exist per se. And let me explain to you. There are now evidence that when the quantity is reduced for reasons other than age, as for example, in case of ovarian endometriosis, there is not a decrease in quality, just a decrease in quantity. Therefore,
There's data on this when they've looked at aneuploidy rates and miscarriages. It's not necessarily correlating with the number of eggs, especially in younger women.
Absolutely. And also, in younger women, we have, in France, we have a donor egg program, and the law in France actually mandates that the donors have to be fertile. And therefore, our donors have had children. They are essentially normal. They are in their early 30s, and we find poor responders, some of them. And we find also that there is no correlation between the number of oocytes we get in the stimulation and the quality of those oocytes, contrary to what you see in infertility. So therefore, there is no inherent links between quantity and quality. It is interesting too that the measures of parameters of quantity, such as, for example, antral follicular count or AFC or AMH, are not correlated with the outcome of IVF. They only predict the number of eggs you get and the type of response, but not they're not predictors of pregnancy. And so in light of this, we thought that the potential usefulness of growth hormone had to be looked at according to those two distinct issues, quantity and quality. And actually, to make the long story short, the amount of data that has been presented and exists suggests that growth hormone may actually improve oocyte quality.
Quality, but not quantity.
Exactly. And this is probably why it has taken so long to actually realize that potential effect.
Because when most people have used it and looked at the studies initially, the surrogate marker of simple egg number was looked at and was much easier to assess than the quality issue.
It has been also because people before have believed that the two were linked. They are only because of the confounding effect of either age or sometimes just the cause of infertility.
So before we get into the subgroup analyses that you did, there's so much confusion I see on practitioners about what dosage to use. And in our postgraduate courses and in discussions in the hallways and when you read the literature, people have used dosages from as little as 4 IUs per day up to 24 IUs, some people dosing every other day, some people dosing daily. Some reports they start the growth hormone with the stimulation, some they start the growth hormone in the luteal phase, day 21 of the cycle before. So from what you've summarized in the literature, if someone asked you, I want to try growth hormone in my patient, what stimulation would I use? Could you guess, if you had to give it to your patient, which protocol would you pick?
It appears that you're right. The data is not entirely clear, but it appears that 4 IUs per day started concomitantly with the onset of ovarian stimulation appears to be kind of a middle approach and would be the one I would choose myself for my patients.
So you would start it with the stimulation, not the cycle before, and at 4 IUs per day?
4 to 8 IUs per day would be the start dose, and there is no evidence that starting a few days before is actually necessary. Evidently, it would be advisable to test those various protocols in the same type of patients.
Yes, obviously. I mean, unfortunately, there's so much heterogeneity here. People are confused as to where to start. So let me ask you about the subsets that you looked at. The first group was the older patient with poor ovarian reserve, and the Tesserick study was the largest one here of 100 women in a randomized controlled trial. What was your summation of the effect of growth hormone in the older, poor responder patient?
that particular trial conducted in Spain is probably the best one in terms of methodology. And in that particular case, all the patients were over 40, and therefore probably had a combined alterations of both quantity and quality. And they were also extremely poor prognosis patients, and therefore finding an improvement is the most encouraging of all the data that we reported.
They had on average, I think, 3 failed previous IVF cycles. So this is a classic patient we see in the United States, older patient, multiple IVF failures.
Exactly. So this is probably the strongest of all data available currently published by Tesarik, Jan Tesarik and collaborators.
And their delivery and live birth rates were 22% versus 5%. The pregnancy rates. The pregnancy rates were 22% versus 5%, I believe.
The pregnancy rate was, the delivery rate was 22% versus 4%, which was statistically significant.
In your paper, that was the first group, was the classic older, poor responder. Then you looked at a second group that you called unselected poor responders. Could you describe who that is? These were the previous poor response, low egg number, but not necessarily age.
Yeah, the second study in terms of its amount of patients included, it comes from Turkey. It was authored by Kusuk. And had a large number of patients. They were poor responders as per past experience. They were in a normal age group actually, with 35 years being their mean age. And interestingly enough, there was a very high incidence of smokers in that study. An incidence of smokers that we in Western Europe and in North America will not commonly encounter in our IVF populations. More than 50% were active smokers. And therefore, there are reasons to believe, knowing what smoking does to oocyte quality, that even though it is not entirely clear, that a large fraction of those poor responders actually had an egg quality issue. And therefore, that the treatment was effective there is encouraging for the ability to improve oocyte quality. Obviously, the issue of smoking is better treated by quitting, but that goes without saying.
Yes, yes. So in this group, what was the magnitude, what was the primary effect they saw? Was it on egg number, quality, or pregnancy?
Yeah. In the study by Kusuk, the improvement is essentially expressed by an improvement in outcome, and therefore that signifies an improvement mainly in oocyte quality.
Right, so this group is, they're not age-related, but they've had previous poor response.
This is a group that was selected for previous poor response and were given a poor responder protocol that had a 450 units of gonadotropin per day design. There was in that study a slight increase in oocyte quantity, but the primary improvement was in outcome and in implantation and pregnancy rates.
Now, there were 2 studies that you chose to highlight that were not randomized controlled studies. One was the Schoolcraft, one was Jovich, that looked at potential benefit in a similar population. What was the major impact that you could take from those 2 studies, the take-home message? Was there a benefit or not?
And the study by Jovich is obviously interesting. It is weakened by the fact that he's changed the protocol halfway through the treatment. Fortunately, without differences between the treated and controls, and also by the fact that people were offered to choose which arm they would be included in for the first treatment, then crossed over. In spite of that weakness, Jovic saw an improvement in oocyte quality, and so did, but indirectly, Bill Schoolcraft, who used a combined approach for poor responders that associate growth hormone, but also a specially conceived protocol called the microflare that associates a mini dose of agonist and a high dose of gonadotropin in a quote-unquote short protocol type.
Right, this is very commonly used in the U.S., the microdose flare.
It's used in our group too, but the Schoolcraft study is not prospective and randomized and looked at a measure taken for poor responders, which included the protocol and the growth hormone. His good outcome, however, strongly speaks in people who had previously performed poorly, strongly speaks for an effect of growth hormone on oocyte quality.
So the next group that you looked at were people who had previous poor ART cycles, and one was the Hazout study that was not in the meta-analyses. Can you describe how this group is different than the other two subgroups of the age and the non-age related poor outcomes?
The study by Hazout and also associates as a co-author Tesserik is interesting because it looked at presumably a group of patients whose primary problem is an oocyte quality issue. These are people who had repeated IVF failures. And all of us do have some of those patients at the end of the year, and they are hard to treat, hard to understand the issue. They have either have poor oocyte quality as per morphology, or even sometimes do not have poor quality embryos. But they are poor performers. They are people with repeated IVF failures with no evidence, no cause being evident. In his
they have good egg number, and it's not necessarily age related, but they have poor embryo quality and poor outcomes.
They have is primarily poor outcome. Some have poor embryo quality and repeated IVF failures.
Right, so in their group, it was almost 300 women who had failed at least three IVF cycles.
Exactly. The weakness of the study is that enrollment was probably volunteered, and they looked at a controlled population that was not precisely matched and clearly not randomized. But in spite of that, the interest is that the population studied in which they saw an improvement was a well-selected group in whom the issue is one of quality and not one of quantity. And in that group, the growth hormone actually had an impact where we expect it now, on quality, therefore on outcome.
And they had a 25 versus 19% pregnancy rate, an increase in the pregnancy rate as well.
They had an increase in pregnancy rate, which is the essence of outcome.
But the criticism that you brought up was in the paper that they were not clearly matched on both FSH and age, that the study population may have been a somewhat better prognosis patient.
You're breaking up now, badly.
Sorry. The is this a little better here?
A little better, just a little.
I'm moving around in the room just to get to a better spot. So one of the criticisms that you raised in your paper was that it was not randomized and that the study population had a slightly younger age and a slightly better FSH. So do you think we can...
We in the paper actually emphasize that very clearly. We hesitated into whether we would include that study or not because it has those weaknesses. We felt it was interesting because in spite of the weaknesses, it had over other studies that were part of the meta-analysis, it had a fairly well-defined population, and a population that precisely had the issue at stake, a decrease in oocyte, therefore in embryo quality.
Now, you chose to do a next step that was unusual in articles looking at where there's treatment controversy. You chose to survey experts from around the world and ask them, what do you do actually in your practice? Can you comment about, you know, why you did this and what they told you they do in their real world practice?
You broke up. The question is why we did the study, why we did the review?
No.
Right. Oh yeah, you're right. Okay, I got you. Okay, you're totally breaking up now, but I think I understood the question. It relates to why we send queries to a group of investigators, a group of practitioners. We had the impression.
Why you did that, and what they told you they do in the real world.
Yeah, right. Now I don't know what you've done, but the quality is not good. We actually, writing the article and reviewing the studies existing, we were puzzled by the fact that our impression was that the use was actually very limited in actual life, and therefore not being in the capability of conducting a formal study, we figured that having the opinion of a group of individuals who were selected by the fact that they come from several countries and by the fact that they are accustomed to the use in our specialty and also are participating in major conventions and conferences and are generally considered as leaders of opinion.
What did they tell you that they do in their practice?
Response that growth hormone was used by a minority and fairly routinely and not at all by the others.
And in essence, the only practitioners who use growth hormone in poor response were in the U.S.
So only in the U.S.?
The sampling that we did is small, but in that sampling, only in the U.S. And we also were amazed by the fact that there were no gray zones. We had people who used it and others who did not at all, which probably is what actually exists in reality, a small number of groups who probably use it and the majority who don't use it at all.
What do you do in your center? Do you use it?
Actually, we cannot use growth hormone in France. It is highly regulated. Because it was identified as a product for which abuse may exist. And therefore, we cannot use growth hormone without having the counseling and the approval of a pediatrician or a specialist in growth. And therefore, we do not, and none of us do in France. And it is essentially because we felt biased going into these studies that we wanted to have a larger opinion and actually ask some of our colleagues in other countries. We believe that
from what you learned, if your regulatory environment allowed you to use it, if you were free to use it, would you?
If we were free to use it, we would set up a study. And I think that probably, and we hope that article would spark the impetus in many groups to actually conduct studies. Hopefully, in the in well-defined subpopulation that we have talked about, and hopefully in subgroups of people who have presumably poor embryo quality.
So for the people, yes, that was my question. If you were going to pick the one group where you think there's most likely to be a benefit, how would you define that poor responder group that you would want to study? Which subgroup is most likely to be the one?
There are two subgroups at stake. The first one, obviously, is the people who are poor, who have a poor outcome because of age. Yet, in that subgroup, miracles may not occur, and therefore we're dealing with people whose outcome will always be limited. The other subgroup, which I think is more interesting and I would actually target my efforts on, if I had the possibility, it would be exactly the group that Hazout has looked at, but with a proper methodology. The individuals who have had poor outcome IVF with embryos, but no pregnancies in a repeated manner. People who've gone through three IVF, proper or improper embryos, but no pregnancies. These are potentially the people who might benefit, provided you have excluded a uterine issue. These are the people who are most likely to benefit from an improvement in embryo quality through an
improvement of oocyte quality and possibly to the machinery, the cytoplasmic machinery.
Thank you so much for speaking to me today about your fantastic paper on growth hormone and poor responders, Dominique. I hope that the readers who see this will be encouraged to take up the study and give us a definitive answer to this question.